Good morning, students. How are you? As you know, I have completed a sexual reproduction in plants and animals. A sexual reproduction I have to just again cover. So first of all, I want to discuss about reproduction. It is the process by which new individual organisms are produced from their parents. Reproduction is a fundamental feature of all living life. Individual exists as a result of reproduction. So bache, today I'm just going to discuss a full topic of reproduction, including asexual reproduction in plants and animals. Ke liye we have just sent a separate video, so let's discuss. Reproductive organisms create new individuals that look very much like themselves. Organisms look similar because their body designs are similar. Different members of species look similar because their body design is similar. It means all of them possess the same blueprint for similar body design. The same blueprint in all member of species comes through interbreeding, like they have received their hereditary material having same information about body design encoded in it. Their hereditary material is copied and then transmitted to next generation during reproduction through gametes, and the hereditary material maintains continuity between the successive generations, and the gametes form the physical basis through which that material is passed on the member of the next generation, and the reproduction is the means of transmission. So dear students, who is holding our body design? Do organisms create exact copy of themselves? Yes. The hereditary material stores blueprint for all body structure, and this hereditary material is DNA. Informations are encoded in the sequence of nucleotides in DNA. DNA molecule contain all information to make specific proteins, which is turned from enzyme to control chemical reactions in the body. These chemical reactions govern the metabolism of body and produce specific correctors. Thus, for transmitting the correctors to next generation, DNA form its copies to transfer to new formed DNA cell. So DNA in the cell is the nucleus, is an information source for making protein. If information is changed, different proteins will be formed. Different protein will lead to a different body design. So basic event in the reproduction is the creation of DNA, and this create DNA by the concept of DNA replication. Like it consists of DNA, during the DNA replication, DNA form exact copy of its own, but mistake many in this process of replication occur. There occur some changes called mutations, and these two cells receiving copy of DNA from the parent cell have certain variations. These variations are called mutations. It can be small, it can be large. Thus, all reproductive gametes may not carry exactly the same characters. Due to mistakes in the DNA replication, there is an introduction of variations, and these variations are passed to the next generation through the process of reproduction. So, creation of DNA copy bring about variations. From the above discussion, it is clear that first step in the reproduction is the replication of DNA. Some variation in the hereditary materials are often introduced at each DNA replication. In multicellular organisms during sexual reproductions, millions of DNA copies are formed and large number of variant gametes and individuals are formed. And this chance of introduction of variation can be type of DNA replication. Like these variation can be introduced during the DNA replication, at the time of gamete formation, and at the time of fertilization. At any time, these variations can be formed, and these variations which provide suitable characters enable the organism for better survival. Such changes which power an organism to survive successfully in some changed environment are called pre-adaptations. Some of the variation is not good, like it might be so drastic that the new DNA copy cannot work with the cellular apparatus it inherited. Such a newborn cell will simply die. Now we will discuss about mode of reproduction. There are two mode of reproduction. One is asexual reproduction and one is sexual reproduction. So let's discuss about asexual reproduction. asexual reproduction is a type of reproduction which occurs without the formation and fusion of gametes. It is called asexual reproduction because it does not involve special cells called sex cells, gametes. Only one parent is needed to produce a new organism. Asexual reproduction is uniparental, does not involve fusion of gametes. It is a method of rapid multiplication. Daughter organisms are genetically identical to the parents. Here, there are certain methods are given: fission, fragmentation, regeneration, budding, vegetative propagation, spore formation. We will discuss one by one every method in detail. First method of asexual reproduction in unicellular organism is fission. Fission is the simplest and common method of asexual reproduction in unicellular organism like protozoa, amoeba, paramecium, leishmania, bacteria. In fission, a unicellular organism split into two or more identical parts and each part later become a complete organism. It is of two type: binary fission, multiple fission. So first of all, we will discuss about binary fission. Binary fission, a unicellular organism reproduces by dividing into two individual. A parent organism split into two small but identical daughter organism. It occurs in unicellular organism like amoeba, paramecium, leishmania, bacteria. If we're just talking about binary fission in amoeba, during unfavorable conditions for growth and development, amoeba reproduced by binary fission. During this process, nucleus of amoeba divides into two and followed by division of cytoplasm. In this way, a parent amoeba divides into two daughter amoebas. See, this is a binary fission in leishmania. In this fission occur along transverse leishmania is a parasitic protozoa which disease cause Kala Azar. It has a flagella at the interior and its body divided by longitudinal binary fission. First two flagellas are formed, then nucleus and then body divide lengthwise. Now come to a multiple fission. Multiple fission occur unfavorable conditions. During multiple fission, organisms secrete a protective covering cyst around the cell. Inside the cyst, nucleus divides several times to form a number of daughter nuclei. Each daughter nucleus surrounded by a cytoplasm. Thus, a large number of daughter individuals are formed. On the arrival of favorable conditions, the structure, single cell daughter individuals are set free and each grow into complete organism. It occurs in the plasmodium, that is a filarial parasite. It produces about 1,000 daughter organisms, and these daughter organisms are called merozoite. They invade red blood cell of man and causes malaria. Now let's discuss the fragmentation method in a simple undifferentiated multicellular organism. Fragmentation. It is the process of breaking up of body of organism into two or more fragments and each of which is growing into a new individual. It is a common method of asexual reproduction in multicellular organism with simple organization. For example, Spirogyra breaks into a small fragments on maturation and these fragments grow into a new individual. Next is a regeneration. Regeneration is the simplest differentiated multicellular organism. Now, next method is regeneration. Regeneration is a getting back of full new organism from a cut part of organism. In this, you can see in diagram that individual is somehow cut or broken down into many pieces and many of the pieces grow into a separate individual. Example, planaria. So, why it is like regenerating to individual? Because it consists of specialized cells. These cells multiply and make a large number of cells. From this mass of cells, different cells undergo changes to become a various cells, tissues. So what we have discussed? Fission, we have discussed fragmentation, we have discussed about regeneration. Now what you have to do? You have to do this question in your notebook. How does binary fission different from multiple fission? Can you think of reason why a more complex organism cannot give rise to new individual through regeneration? So what type of asexual reproduction? Here you have to just tell. Fission, fragmentation, regeneration, budding, vegetative propagation, spore formation. Here two examples of unicellular organisms. Amoeba, in which binary fission takes paramecium and euglena. So what are, give one difference between binary fission and multi fission. Two daughter cells are produced in binary fission, multiple fission many daughter cells are produced. In binary fission we can just add one more difference, like no cyst wall formed. In multiple fission cyst wall are formed. So now we have to discuss about budding. It is in lower differentiated multicellular organism. So now come to our next budding. It is in multicellular organism. Organisms such as hydra use regenerative cells for budding. In hydra, bud arise from a body surface as an outgrowth. This bud enlarge and develop tentacles. Then fully formed bud separates from parent body and starts an independent life. Is that clear? So what do you mean by budding? Budding, bud develop as outgrowth due to repeated division at one specific site. These bud develop into a tiny individual and the fully mature detach from parent body and become a new independent individual. Now next is a vegetative propagation in complex multicellular plants. Vegetative propagation, next method. It is a form of asexual reproduction where part of plant body such as root, stem, leaf develop into new plant. It is a very simplest method of reproduction in plant. Most of the ornamental plants like grasses, orchids, medicinal plants, horticulture plants, plants of economic importance are grown by vegetative propagation. See, here there are some natural methods, there are some artificial methods. These are the methods of multiplication with the help of vegetative propagule which occur in the plants. Here you can see a vegetative propagation by roots. Roots of some plants like sweet potato, dahlia, spirulina develop into buds. When these such roots are planted to a soil, new plants are produced. Roots of guava plant are also have buds. These buds develop into guava plant. Here is a vegetative propagation by stem. It takes place in sub-individual underground stem, for example in grasses. Stem grow along the surface of soil and produces root where it touches the ground. The lateral branches of such stem that run horizontally is called runner. Other example of stem producing new plants are strawberry through stolon. Underground stems like ginger, potato, onion are also source of vegetative propagation. The eyes present in potato and pulp of onion, rhizoma, ginger give rise to aerial shoot under favorable conditions. Here you can see a vegetative propagation by leaves in a bryophyllum plants. In this you can see buds are present along the margins of the leaves. These buds develop into platelets under favorable conditions. When the leaves fall on ground, platelets and buds develop into new plants. Now come to a artificial method of vegetative propagation. In plants where vegetative propagation by natural means is difficult to occur, man-made methods are carried out. These methods are called artificial propagation of plant. These methods are used in agriculture for raising crops and in horticulture for cultivation of vegetables, fruits and flowers. First method is grafting, the technique of joining shoot system of one plant over the stump of another related plant to form a composite plant is known as grafting. Plant where root system is taken is called stalk and the plant whose shoot system is taken as scion. Stalk is always a plant which is a resistance to disease, has a deep system for absorbing water and minerals, and scion is a better yielding growing plant. Grafting is successful in dicot, not in monocot, because monocots do not have campion. In grafting, stalk and scions are placed over and in such a way that cambium of two is in intimate contact. So what are the advantages of grafting? It is used to improve varieties and production of fruits in mango, apple, pear, guava. Scion may be flower when it's grafted into mature tree. On the same stalk, different varieties can be grafted. Cutting is a common man-made method of vegetative propagation in plants. Stem cutting, root cutting, leaf cutting, these are the methods used for artificial propagation. Stem cutting like rose, sugarcane, lemon, China rose are grown through stem cutting. This stem is grown to be cut into pieces. These cuts are planted into soil. Then cuttings develop into roots and shoots grow into new plants. Each cutting should have at least two nodes and internodes. Root cutting are commonly used in plants like turmeric, black mary. These are taken from healthy plants. These are cut into pieces long and placed in white soil in horizontal position. Roots and shoots develop to form a new plant from this cutting. Leaf cutting is also done by begonia plants. So let's discuss advantages and limitation of VHDT propagation. First of all, advantages of VHDT propagation. It is a cheaper, rapid, convenient method for growing plant. For example, potato only 3 months for producing a new crop when raised from tuber, whereas it takes a 15 month when raised from a seeds. Plants like banana, grapes do not form a viable seed. These plants can be grown only by VHDT propagation. Desirable character of fruits and flowers can be maintained indefinitely. Plants grown by VHDT propagation are of uniform size, quality, taste. Survival rate of new plant is 100%, whereas it will be up to 10% when raised by seeds. By VHDT propagation, plant can be easily introduced into new area. Now come to the limitations of a VHDT propagation. It does not produce new variety. It leads to overcrowding around the main plant, leading to the competition for food and space. Plants lose vigor when growth rapidly. Undesirable characters are transmitted from one generation to another, and disease contracted by parent plants are also transmitted to daughter plants. Comes to a latest technique, that is a tissue culture or micropropagation. This is a technique of propagating plants by culturing cells, tissue in culture medium. When VHDT propagation is not possible in plants, its bird, shoot effects or some other plant is used for micropropagation. This is called explants. Steps involved in micropropagation. First of all, a bud or shoot apex is cultured in a nutrient medium. Soon its cell grow and divide to form a mass of undifferentiated cells called callus. This can be maintained, multiply for a long period. When a small portion of callus is transferred to a nutrient with specific hormone, it differentiates into miniature plants called platelets. After 4 to 6 weeks, platelets are transferred to a pot or to a soil. By this method, indefinite number of plants can be obtained from a small mass of parental tissue. Now come to its advantages. It provides rapid propagation of identical individuals. Very small explants can be used for micropropagation. These plants are always disease-free. It can be carried out throughout the year. Plants grown even from sterile hybrids. Only small space is required for tissue culture. So it is a very good method. Now come to a next method, that is a spore formation in a multicellular organism. Spore formation in fungi like rhizopus, bread mold, thread-like structures called hyphae develop into bread. They bear aerial hyphae called spongiophores. Spongiophore bear at their terminal ends black blob called spongia. Each spongium contains dark-colored spores. Their spores are liberated by a rupture of wall. The spores are covered by a thick wall that protects them until they come in contact with moist surface. They grow into a new rhizopus individual. I hope this is clear to you. Here you can see a diagram. Spongiophore consists of spores. When this wall breaks, then there are loads of spores are liberated, and the spores is a single cell reproductive structure that discharge from parent and give rise to directly or indirectly to a new individual. Non-motile spores which cannot swim are called aplanospores, and flagellated motile spores are called food spores. So what we have discussed? We have discussed budding, we have discussed VHDT propagation, we have discussed spore formation. So here you have to do some question. How will an organism be benefited if it reproduces through spores? Can you think of reason why a complex organism cannot give rise to new individual through regeneration? Why is vegetative propagation practices for growing some type of plants? Explain the process of spore formation. Sexual reproduction is a type of reproduction in which a male gamete fuses with a female gamete to produce a zygote, which ultimately develops to form a new individual. Sexual reproduction is a reproduction that involves two individuals belonging to two different sexes, male and female. These are the two sexes that take part in the mode of reproduction. Sexual reproduction involves sex cells. These sex cells are called gametes, and they are made in reproductive organ. In sexual reproduction, I already told you that male gamete come in contact with female gamete, fuses, that in their cytoplasm and nuclei join together to form a zygote. Zygote grow into individual. Like we will discuss sexual reproduction in plants as well as sexual reproduction in animals. First of all, now we will discuss about certain characteristics of sexual reproduction. Like, but gametes, which I discussed, that gametes are formed in sex organ. It involves reduction or meiotic division, meiosis. Meiosis means reductional division. Gametes have half number of chromosome of the parent cell. Characteristics of sexual reproduction. It is a biparental. Two parents are involved. One is male, one is female. In plant, it involves separate male and female reproductive organs. Gametes are formed by meiotic division, which are haploid. Fusion of male and female gamete from two different parents takes place. As a result of fertilization, zygote is formed. Zygote under repeating mitotic division to form a daughter organism. And then daughter organism is genetically different from both the parents, but resemble in the certain features. But the sexual reproduction, it brings about variation. Now, what is the significance of sexual reproduction? Sexual reproduction, it results in the new combination of gene brought in zygote. This increases genetic variation and diversity of character. Second, it maintains chromosome number in future generation. Next, variation favor evolution, and it play important role in origin of new species. Like, reproduction is essential for continuation of species. Now imagine what have happened if organism had not reproduced. No type, no life. So now, first of all, we will just start sexual reproduction in plants. So let's start a sexual reproduction in plants. Now please tell me, which is a reproductive part of plant? Yes, very good. Flower is a reproductive part of plant. Now we will discuss about parts of flower. Here you can see the structure of the flower. Here you can see flower is born at the tip of stalk called pedicle. Pedicle expands into a fleshy swollen upper portion called thalamus, or also called receptacle. All the flower parts are attached to the thalamus. Flower consists of four main parts: calyx, called sepals; corolla, called petals; androecium, called stamen; gynoecium, called pistil; and carp. Calyx and corolla are accessory pores. These are not reproductive parts. And androecium and gynoecium are reproductive parts of flower. So let's first of all discuss about calyx. Calyx is the outermost hole of flower. It is formed of five green colored leaf like parts called sepals, and the function of the sepal is to protect the flower in bud condition. Now come to corolla. Corolla is also called petals. It is formed of green colored. They lie inner to calyx. They are found in various color. They attract the insects for pollination. Androecium, also called stamen, it is the male reproductive part of flower. They just lie within the corolla. There may be several stamen in the flower. Each stamen consists of two parts. One is anther and one is filament. Anther consists of four pollen sacs. Each pollen sac bears a powdery mass called pollen, and pollen contains pollen grains, and these pollen grains are male gametes. Now come to a gynoecium. Gynoecium is a female reproductive part of flower. It is formed of one or more carpels. Carpels lie in the center of the flower and the flask-shaped structure. Carpel is made up of three parts, stigma, style, ovary. Stigma. Stigma is the upper part of carpel. It receives pollen grains. Male gametes during pollination. Style is a long part of carpel which connects stigma with the ovary. And about ovary, it is the basal part of carpel. Ovary wears ovules. Female gametes called ovum is produced in the ovule. Ovule may be unilocular where there is only one chamber, or it is multilocular when there are many chambers. Okay. Now beta, next is, let's discuss every part one by one in detail. Here you can see a sepals and petals are non-reproductive parts. Petals have a bright color that attract insects for pollination, and sepal is a leaf-like structure protect flower in its bud condition. Stamen is a male reproductive organ which contains sperm. Like, it consists of anther and filament. Pollens are inside the anther which contain two male gametes. Pistil is a female reproductive organ which contains ovum. Ovum means egg. It consists of three parts, stigma, style, ovary. An ovule is inside the ovary which contain one female gamete, or you can say ovum. Now here is description of every part is given. You can read out. Sepal, what is the function of sepals? Protects unopened flower. Petals, brightly colored insect pollinated flowers to attract insects. Anther, it produces and releases male sex cells, pollen grains. Stigma, top of the female part of flower which collect pollen grains. Ovary, produces the female sex cell. Ovule, contain the female sex cell found inside the ovary. Now comes to next concept, that is the types of flower. There are two types of flower, unisexual flower, bisexual flower. Now first of all, let's discuss about unisexual flower. About unisexual flower, flower may be unisexual when it contains either stamen or pistil. Like, examples are papaya, watermelon. Bisexual flower. Bisexual flowers are flowers in which male and female reproductive parts are present in the same flower. Example, mustard and hibiscus. These are example of bisexual flower. Now, we have to discuss about pollination. What is pollination? Pollination is a transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma of a flower. It's called pollination. Pollination is of two types. One is self-pollination, one is cross-pollination. First of all, we will discuss about self-pollination. Self-pollination is a transfer of pollen grains occur in the same flower. Or you can say, it is a transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma of the same flower or another flower of the same plant. Example, it most of the time it takes place in bisexual plant. Example, groundnut and garden balsam. Next is cross-pollination. It is a transfer of pollen grain from anther from one plant to stigma of another flower of another plant but of the same species. It is possible in both the unisexual as well as bisexual flower. Examples are China rose, marigold, maize. These are cross-pollination may be completed with the help of insects, birds, wind and water. Now comes to the agents of the cross-pollination. Cross-pollination occur by insects. How? Here there are most steps are there. First of all, pollens from stamen stick to a bee as it visits a flower to collect food. Bee travel to another plant of the same type. Then pollens on bee sticks to a pistil of flower on another plant. In this, male organ is just passed to a female. Fertilization takes place. This is a cross-pollination by insects. Now, what are the adaptation for pollination? In this, these are very, very important. We'll have to discuss about features of the insect pollinated flower. In features of the insect pollinated flower, petals are very light, large and brightly colored to attract insects. Present, nectar is present and to visit the flower and push past at stamen to get a nectar. Pollen grains are moderate. Insects transfer pollen grains efficiently with a high chance of successful for pollination. Pollen grains are large, sticky, spiky to attach insects and be carried away. Anther. Insect flower stiff and firmly attached to a brush against insects. Stigma. Inside a flower sticky, so pollen grains stick to it when insect brushes past. Now here you can see the diagram where everything is given, which I discussed with you the features of insect pollinated flowers. Now we will discuss about cross pollination by wind. Here you can see the diagram where we will discuss about features of the wind pollinated. Wind pollinated flower consists of petals that are very small, dull, often green or brown in color. Nectar is most of the time scent or a nectar. It is absent. No need to waste energy producing these as no need to attract insects. Number of pollen grains large. Most pollen grains are not transferred to another flower, so more produce better than the chance of some successful pollination occurring. Pollen grains are smooth, small, light, so they are easily blown by wind. Anther. Outside the flower, swimming blues or long filaments to release pollen grain easily. Stigma. Outside flower, feathery to catch drifting pollen grains. So, insect pollinated flower produce smaller amount of large, heavier pollen grains that contain spikes on the outside, so they are better able to stick to the insects. On the other hand, wind pollinated flower produce large amount of small, lightweighted pollen grains that are usually smooth. Here the diagram shown pollen grains from three different species of plant as they appeared under a microscope. 1, 2, 3. Now you have to just tell me which pollen grains are involved in insect pollination. 1 and 2, 1 only, 2 and 3, 3 only. This assignment. Now next concept is fertilization, a process in which sperm fuses with egg. Let's discuss in detail. First of all, what happens? Fertilization, fusion of male and female gamete, male nucleus from pollen grain with egg nucleus to form zygote. This is called fertilization. As a result of pollination, pollen grain is deposited on the stigma of carpel. It grows into a pollen tube. Up here you can see, after the pollens land on stigma, tube go out of pollen grain and travel through style to reach pollen grain. Is that clear? So in this way, pollen tube is... Then, male gamete. The pollen tube contains two male gametes. It releases two male gametes into embryo sac. Okay, male gamete, one male gamete travels through tube and reaches to the ovule where female gamete is waiting. Then male gamete fuses with the egg to form zygote, and this fusion of the male gamete with egg to form zygote is called syngamy. Is that clear? Now, what happens after post-fertilization changes? Formation of embryo. Zygote divides several times to form embryo within the ovule, and embryo gradually develops within the ovule. Now, conversion of ovary and ovule into fruit and ovule develop a tough coat converted into seed. Ovary grow rapidly, ripen to form fruit. Meanwhile, petals, sepals, stamen, style, stigma, vesicle, and fall off. Now, germination of seed we discuss. In germination, seed contain future plant or embryo which develop into seedling under appropriate conditions. This process is known as germination. Like plumule is a future plant, radical is a future root, plumule is a future shoot, and cotyledonous helps to store food. Now comes to a we have discussed about fertilization. Like I just told you that pollen tube container two male gametes, it releases two male gametes into embryo sac. I just discussed that one of the male gamete fuses with the egg to form zygote, and ultimately fertilization take place and form the. But now what about the other male gamete? There was two male gametes. The other male gamete fuses with the two polar nuclei to form endosperm, and this fusion of one male gamete with two polar nuclei is called triple fusion. Is that clear? So in ovary, two fusion take place. These are syngamy and triple fusion, and these two processes are called double fertilization. Now, what is the function of endosperm? To provide nourishment to a developing embryo. So till now we have discussed about sexual reproduction in plant. Very soon we will discuss about sexual reproduction in animals. Goodbye. In the end, I would like to say thank you. Please be prepared for exam.